All right, I'm going to get us started. Welcome to Pondering Excellence, the monthly, occasionally bi-monthly event during the school year that Center for Support Center to Support Excellence in Teaching. I've worked here a month or two. I'm almost got the name down. Hosts in order to encourage conversation about excellence in teaching, and I ask our presenters often to keep the floor open for dilemmas, ponderings, challenges in their work. Our talks are usually something based in research that people have done. In this case, that's exactly what's going on. Mary Hauser, Mike Metz, Sarah Kavanagh, representing three fine institutions, but all having very tight ties to CSET. Mary is a current doctoral student here. Mike is our mighty graduate, who is a assistant professor at the University of Missouri right now. And Sarah was our illustrious postdoc until the University of Washington lured her back. So they've continued to collaborate and work on the stuff I won't tell you about because their talk will be much better than anything I could say. But they are a lovely example of collaboration in every sense of the word, from how they work in terms of the intellectual grappling that they do, to their engagement with projects that are based at the center, to how they bring in thinking from other places. So I'm really excited to have them as our collaborative speakers today. And I think we have a nice sized group to do a very quick set of introductions, because I know lots of you know each other, but not all of you know each other. And maybe kind of name whatever you consider your affiliation and why this talk. Mary, I'll let you pass. Thank you. Okay.
Sharon Parker. I am instructional science coach for CSET, and I've just been hearing inklings of the research in the air. And so I'm super excited to see and hear what you guys have to share.
Nicole Luciani Elliott, I'm an instructional coach for CSET and specifically on the Hollyhock Fellowship as well as some others. And I'm really excited to hear about whether what we're doing is having any kind of an impact.
And Nicole works in the areas of?
Predominantly history and equity.
I'm Tara Garcia. I'm a newish assistant professor here in the GSC. Do LSTD CTE stuff. Acronyms work for people. And the topic just sounded really interesting. I'm looking forward to learning with you all here.
And Tara, I was actually out of town during last month's Pondering Excellence, so I don't know if this is your first or
I came to Laura's.
I thought you might have. That's why I was asking. Javier, then Melissa.
I am Javier Hines. I'm the executive administrator here at CSET, and I too have kind of caught some wisps and vapor trails in the air of what this talk might be about, so I'm planting myself here for the whole thing.
I'm Melissa Sheedy. I work at CSET too, and work on Hollyhock, particularly in English, and I've just been following this research that Mary and Sarah and Mike and Janet and a whole group of people have been doing, and so I'm really excited to hear about this. I know they're presenting at AARA soon, and so I'm just excited to hear the first percolations of this.
I'm Steve Kim. Mary and I are married. my wife. I'm her husband. I know the three have been working on this for a long time, and I'm here to find out what it's all about, and also for moral support.
I'm Sarah McGrew. I'm a doctoral student in CTE. I do history education. And yeah, have done some work with Sarah and Mary, so we're here to support them, but also try to think about this stuff in the context of history education. I'm really excited to learn from them.
All right, so I'm going to take care of another CSET business thing that's been on my to-do list forever. Sarah, make sure you talk to Nicole. We need to engage. We're getting a growing portfolio of social studies history work that's quite interesting and is beyond the School of Ed, and we want to link more CTE history folks in with that work. And you are on my list to connect to Nicole as well as find out who else in history you think might be interested.
Just cross that off.
Yes, Nicole and Sarah. All right, Rebecca.
I'm Rebecca Berge. I'm also instructional coach with Hollyhock and interested in how research and practice are informing each other. So excited to hear about it.
And you are also on my list if we can grab a few minutes at the end.
Yep.
Just brush them off. That's the only reason I show up.
I'm Tammy Moriarty. I'm also on staff as an instructional coach, particularly in science, and work on a number of different projects. And I am very excited to hear what this team has, what findings they have for us, and also the to think about implications for how we can improve our work here at CSET.
And a couple of people in the room know this. I don't think Sarah and Mike do. Tammy is beginning a transition to being part of the Hollyhock research internal team. So we have some science funding going down, so I'm going to bring her up because she's got this latent side of her we haven't been able to access.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Hello, everyone. Angela, Sarah. Hi, Mike and Sarah.
Hi.
I'm also on the Hollyhock project for history, and really excited to hear your findings.
Mm-hmm. All right, I'm going to turn it over to the three of you because they're obviously not here to talk to me.
Okay, so thanks for doing the introductions, and I think the most important thing that I wanted to say at the beginning is that, you know, Mike and Sarah and I have ended up working specifically on this paper, but it rests on the extraordinary work of the whole Hollyhock team, so the people who identified themselves as part of that team. I didn't know how many of our team members and how many not would be in the room, but I just want to make sure that we say that this paper is really based on everyone's work. So, okay. So because it's me and Mike and Sarah, I would like to start off with a poem. What I'm really starting off with is a clip of discussion from an 11th grade literature class in Hartford, Connecticut. And the class is talking about this poem called Identity Blues by Alok Vaidmenon. Before we look at the clip, I wanted to give you a minute to think about this poem, so I'll just stop and let you read it for a second. So every time I've read this poem, I've been really intrigued by the last line. Sometimes when I answer, water comes out. And so I wanted to give you just a moment to turn and talk to the person next to you. What do you make of that line? Go ahead and turn and talk for a second.
Good to see you again.
What was your initial reaction at first?
Came out of nowhere.
But I think that's the way in which water comes out. Yeah. Yeah. Isn't the way that you would describe water coming out as different parts of our body or water could come out, right? Kind of made me wonder, do they mean tears? Do they mean some other function, like is it about like place connected to gender, like it was just...
Okay, so I'm going to have to interrupt you because it sounds like there are quite a lot of ideas. But let's take just a minute to talk about it. So can we hear a couple of interpretations? Maybe someone can start off and then others can kind of jump in and build. What do you think? Any thoughts on this line?
I'll start. Okay, I'm thinking of, I have my cultural ethnic lens on. And so the word that comes to me is diaspora. And so I think of where folks are and how folks got here. And so on that last line in particular, I was sort of thinking around Middle Passage and the water and all of that. So.
Other thoughts?
I had an image of a water balloon. I was saying because I have two boys who tend to create havoc with things like water balloons. But I was thinking about how sometimes they burst and sometimes they leak, but in the end the water always comes out. And so I kind of felt like there was a truth aching to be seen, and that's what I drew from.
I think I related it to actual bodily function, because I was like, sometimes when I try to answer, I get so upset that water comes out. So I thought about tears, and even when you're really crying hard, you can kind of, you know, have saliva coming out of your mouth or what have you. So I wondered about that.
Yeah, I think that the first time I read it, I had a similar thought, that it was about being so angry that you know, it was saliva coming out or something to that effect. But I don't know, I've read this poem with a number of different groups, and I'm always just fascinated to hear what people do make of that last line, because it brings up such different interpretations. We can look at what the students in this classroom thought about it, but first I just wanted to say that, we had a very brief conversation, and I'm not totally sure that we did the work of building on each other's ideas. Maybe if we had if we had kept going for a minute, we would have. But had we kind of continued with that conversation, maybe we would have met these standards that the Common Core Speaking and Listening Standards sets out for students, so that they initiate and participate effectively in a range of collaborative discussions where they're building on others' ideas and expressing their own clearly and persuasively. And that, you know, these discussion skills are valued in other subject areas as well. In science standards, students are asked to construct explanations, engaging argument from evidence, and in math, construct viable arguments as well. So now I'd like to show you that 11th grade clip. And so this first clip here is just the teacher launching the discussion. So you'll see kind of how she sets it up and how one student begins it. And then I'll switch to another clip which picks up in the middle of the discussion, so you can see some of the facilitation work that the student is doing.
The shock? Oh my god. So the poem that I had you guys look at was called Identity Blues by Alok Vain Mangum. And this was the first time that you were taking a look at it. And right now we are trying to understand what is even going on in this poem through how you guys interpreted it using the up, down, why. So I'm going to stay as quiet as possible. And I want you guys to try to drive this discussion a little bit. So Shinjali, I know you had asked to start. So
the first thing I wanted to talk about was the first writing, because those words I really kind of understood a lot. So like, I wanted to talk about like what's the connection to dysphoria and the other one is dysphoria. And like, we first talked about this.
Okay, so that's the setup, and then this is picking up in the middle of the discussion. And as you're watching this clip, think to yourself, maybe, what does it take to learn how to facilitate a discussion like this? What might someone need to practice, and how might they need to practice in order to facilitate something like this?
I don't know. To me, being important in your own body is like looking close to the mirror and feeling like you don't belong. You don't feel good about yourself or your self-appearance. That reminds me of the moment you were doing, see how she said I should put people who like her lips belong to her. And also, I think people were like transgender people like that. Like somebody born as a male, of course, but then, like, you know how over time they start getting with those and stuff, but they change, so they get an operation and stuff. That makes me think, like, so that's like they not said that I was their buddy, but when they were little, maybe they were just going with it because they just, like, they didn't want to have people to change with them.
Okay, that's
Do you see anything that kind of mentions that idea? Yeah, right. Mentions that idea in the poem specifically? Why do you say that? That's kind of a bold statement there. Why do you think, and this is something that I have no idea myself, so this is like an authentic question I'm asking, why water? Oh, okay, I can see that. Anybody else?
So what does it take to learn how to facilitate? What would someone need to practice, and how might they need to practice in order to figure out how to do this work? Take a minute to turn and talk to the person next to you.
And also, I think that the questions the coach has have to be ones that are not leading questions. You're not trying to get kids to say something specific, but rather open-ended enough for them to build the discussion themselves.
Yeah, that's why
there's a right. And the questions build on whatever the kids were talking about, because otherwise you might cut off the discussion. So your question needs to be inserted in a way that helps them build more rather than pulls away from what they're trying to
accomplish.
Well, that's when she asked that question about, is there anything in the text that connects to your comic, and then that brought them back into the text. Even though they were talking about the text, that brought them back to the text and ground their interpretation. And it wasn't done in a way that's like, what's your evidence for that? You know, that's been a very,
So, I know that a number of you have thought about this pretty extensively in your respective content areas, so what do you think? What are some of the things that you would need to practice, or ways that you would need to practice in order to work on this type of conversation?
One of the things we talked about is, or at least what I have the hardest time with teachers and with discussion, is that teachers can trust themselves and that they can trust their kids. and then and doing the work to prepare themselves so that trust is not unfounded.
I think related to that is the idea that if you don't have a vision of what this kind of discussion looks like, it's hard to learn how to facilitate it. And so being able to sort of practice it, I call it a discussion, might be a part of the process.
I think also learning to be flexible enough to have some big, meaty questions planned, but also let what your kids are saying actually change the course of the discussion. So like having a goal, but not a destination.
Yeah, connecting to what you're saying, what Jana was saying, the vision, I think, has to be about the quality of the uptake that the students have rather than leading them to a right answer. And so what I appreciated about the questions this teacher asked is it wasn't pressing students toward a particular interpretation. It was like trying to help them build on each other's ideas. And that's the vision rather than, well, this is the way you interpret this poem. And those leading questions can really actually just totally cut off discussion for students.
But I also think that for some teachers this is really hard because it's about control. Mm-hmm. And so you also need to practice what that looks like to let go of some control gradually and see what the kids show you they can do so that you can kind of get them where they need to go and you yourself as well.
I think that letting go piece is about sometimes students need silence, right, and they're processing that. And I know as newer teachers, there's a need to fill space, right, and that discomfort of silence is something that needs to
be. I think there's an important distinction in what Sarah was talking about with the idea of a goal but not a destination. So it's not that anything goes in the class, but this idea of space for student thought and direction.
I'd be really curious how she got her kids to this place and how she got herself to this place.
Yeah.
Because it's so, when I looked at, I mean, so many kids spoke so meaningfully and she did such a great job of holding back and letting them keep them more. And kids don't come to us naturally doing that. So I'd be really curious the moves that she made to scaffold mm-hmm. them.
Okay. So this question of how to practice and what to practice, it depends on what our vision of teaching is, as some of you have sort of pointed out here. And so obviously at this point, there are a lot of different folks who have tried to define and describe ambitious, high quality teaching. But one thing that I think that most definitions of high quality teaching have in common is an emphasis on the idea of responsive instruction. Up here is how we're thinking of responsive instruction in our project here. So it's a dynamic process of eliciting ideas from students, considering those ideas, and figuring out ways to respond to them. It's an emerging interplay between a teacher's instructional goals, the ideas that students express, and the content. It's not something that can be scripted in advance, and it's not something that teachers provide or do to students. So for example, as you all pointed out in this video, it's times like the moment when the teacher says, where did you see that in the text? Or that's a really bold statement. Can you say more about that? Can you explain what you're saying? And maybe it's even those moments of silence that you pointed out where she's, holding the space for her students' ideas to emerge. And so our question sort of going into this project in part was, how do you get good at responsive teaching? If our underlying vision of ambitious instruction is that it's collaboratively negotiated between students and teachers and it's unique to the school, community, and context that's happening in, how do you get good at it before you're actually in the classroom, or how do you work on it when you're in a professional development setting, for example? So we're not the first people who have thought about this question. So there there have been people thinking about this idea of how to get good at responsive teaching. And some things that they've talked about are the need to specify teaching practices like facilitating discussion and modeling, for example, and then to create opportunities for people to practice those specific practices together with colleagues and maybe with the expert coaches. And so a specific way that people have talked about this that many of you are very familiar with is the rehearsal. So for those who aren't as familiar, in this project and in the literature, rehearsal is described as a low-stakes opportunity for teachers to try out an instructional activity with peers and a coach. One thing that's sort of unique to rehearsal is that In the process of doing it, you can, either the rehearsing teacher or the coach can pause and sort of talk through something that's happened or rewind and replay something in a different way to sort of see how it plays out. Janet described it as a VHS tape. It's the teacher practice version of VHS tape the other day. So it's an important aspect of rehearsal that you kind of see coming out a little bit in our data. As many of you know also, all of the teachers who participated in the professional development that we studied were a part of rehearsals during their time in the PhD. So our research question was, what are the characteristics of rehearsals of teaching that support teachers to practice responding to student thinking? So we're thinking of this as, in other words, If we want to know if and how rehearsals gave teachers a chance to practice exercising judgment in relationship to student thinking, rather than just practicing predetermined teacher behaviors. Primarily for Stephen Ontero, the context of the study was the Hollyhock Fellowship Program. So the data that we'll share with you comes from this program. It's a fellowship program for early career high school teachers in years 2 through 7 of their teaching. They participate in 2 summer institutes over 2 consecutive summers and 2 years of online coaching. They come from English, classrooms, social studies, history, science, and math. We looked at the data from the 2015 Summer Institute, which is highlighted in coral. During that institute, all the fellows participated in rehearsals of facilitating discussion specifically. So we collected a bunch of data during that institute, and this is sort of a rundown of what we looked at. So we collected a video of all of the teachers' rehearsals of facilitating discussion. So that amounted to about 64 5- to 30-minute videos of specifically rehearsing discussion. And we also captured video of all of the professional development about discussion specifically. So that's about 42 to 5-hour videos of PD providers facilitating professional development. We collected due to the organizational skills of the people in this room, a large number of PD artifacts, lesson plans, PowerPoints, handouts that were associated with that professional development. And then also following the PD, we asked the lead for each content area to write a structured memo about the way that they approached rehearsal in their content area. So for example, we asked them to talk about what instructions they gave people for what rehearsal would look like, if what type of preparation the teachers did to get ready for rehearsal, and how they framed to people what they would be practicing during the rehearsal. And as we sort of started looking at this data, the memos became a really important point of triangulation to say, okay, here's what we think is coming out of this. So this is what the PD providers were going for.
Mary, this might be too off track.
Mike and Sarah answer all questions.
Okay, that's right. I should have addressed all three. Why did the rehearsals range so greatly in time from 5 to 30 minutes?
So they just did. I mean, some of them were, you know, I think most of the time when they were quite long is because they included a lot of contextualization on the front end. So people were talking a lot about what they were trying to do and their own context and stuff like that. Whereas some of them were just going straight into the rehearsal. Is that question answers? Does that work for you?
Well, I think also what Mary just said about the contextualization taking up time, it's something we're actually going to talk about in a bit in relationship to some other findings. So keep that in mind, right? But contextualization can actually play a large part in rehearsals, and that the extent to which teachers feel the need to contextualize is actually related to a set of ways in which rehearsals are designed. So some rehearsees in some content areas felt the deep need to offer a large contextualization chunk of time, and in other content areas they didn't. And part of what we learned from looking at all this video of rehearsals is why that might be, why the design elements of the rehearsal itself might lead a teacher to feel the need to offer a lot of contextualization or not. So there are design features of rehearsals that would change the amount of time that each rehearsal takes.
So we approach this like a comparative case study. So we know that there was a certain amount of work done to norm on what would go on during these rehearsals across the content areas. But then when people went off to do them in their respective, you know, rooms in the Lee Ka-shing Center, there was this very natural source of variation across the four content areas that we could look at to sort of see, you know, what did people do with this idea of rehearsal. So, like I showed you, we had a whole bunch of data to try to explore the question. And after making a few passes through the data the first time, we decided to partition the analysis into three sections. So we decided to look at the design of the rehearsals, so how people planned and set them up. The facilitation itself, so what went on during the time when the teachers were actually rehearsing, and then the reflection. So we sort of chunked the data and coded it in different ways to get at those three pieces of the way that rehearsals happened. If you would like to know more about our methods, Mike and Sarah will be available to answer questions about them at the end of the talk, but I think I'll just move to the findings now. Our findings fall into three main categories: designing opportunities to practice responsiveness, facilitating opportunities to practice responsiveness, and prompting reflection on responsiveness. I'm going to talk about all three of them in turn. So as far as design goes, you know, in PD we're often trying to do a whole lot of different things for good or bad, and what we found was that the design of the rehearsal really, there was a lot of variation in how much the teachers were able to make choices about what it was that they were practicing. So we ended up coming up with this sort of idea here of the level of constraint of the rehearsals. So we talk about on the left side here, tightly constrained rehearsals are one where the PD provider makes most of the decisions about the lesson being rehearsed. And consequently, at least in this case, it narrowed the focus of what teachers were practicing in the rehearsal. So in the case of the tightly constrained rehearsals at Hollyhock, teachers were focused on practicing, eliciting, and responding to student thinking. Most of the teachers were kind of practicing that thing, and it was sort of to the exclusion of other things that they might have been practicing. On the other side here, we have loosely constrained rehearsals where the teachers made quite a number of decisions about the lesson being rehearsed, and they were consequently sometimes practicing a lot of things at once. So for example, they might have been practicing eliciting, responding to student thinking, plus selecting texts for discussion, plus an unfamiliar instructional routine. And sometimes what happened was that then teachers were practicing sort of different things from one another. So the main point here is that what we saw is that the more constrained the rehearsal was, the more we saw teachers focusing on eliciting and responding to student thinking. So the question remains then, like, what were the types of constraint that we saw in the data? And there were sort of four main types of constraint that we saw the PD providers making decisions around these things. The disciplinary content, the instructional routine, the texts for discussion, and facilitation moves. So this actually is really best illustrated through the example of two of the content areas. So let me show you how this actually worked in English and history. So I'll talk about English first, which is on the left, and we found the English rehearsals to be the most tightly constrained rehearsals. So the English PD providers pre-selected the text for the teachers. They had a choice of two poems to work on. All of the teachers were working on this pretty familiar routine of a sense-making discussion in an English class. It's a fairly foundational structure for English teachers. And the PD providers were quite explicit about the facilitation moves that teachers should be practicing. They represented 8 moves to them and then decomposed them and showed them the moves via video exemplar. So history, which we considered sort of a moderately constrained rehearsal. So in the case of history, the teachers selected the sources that they were going to talk about with their students who were actually their peers. So the instructional routine is probably familiar to some teachers, but not all. It may be a new routine for some history teachers. It's also arguably a little bit more complex to do a conversation with multiple primary sources as opposed to just one single text. And then similar to English, the history folks did represent and decompose facilitation moves, although maybe not to the same extent that the English did. So this is not really to say that, you know, we don't want to say that more or less constraint is a good or a bad thing. The point here is that the constraints shaped what ended up getting practiced. So it's just something to think about, again, in the design of rehearsals. So I want to show you a couple of examples from our video data. One from these highly constrained English rehearsals, and then one from science, which we considered more loosely constrained than the English. So this is a teacher so both of these come from the launch of a rehearsal, at the very beginning. This teacher is getting ready to talk about the poem, "The Boy Died in My Alley," by Gwendolyn Brooks. And as you watch these two clips, I'd just like you to think about the differences between the two examples, and we'll take a moment to discuss afterwards.
All right, so we've spent the last 20 or so minutes doing some really great analysis of The Boy Died in My Alley by Gwendolyn Brooks. And something that I've noticed a lot coming out of these conversations is how much ambiguity there is, whether it's ambiguity of who the speaker of the poem is, whether it's using oxymorons and kind of figuring out what the meaning of that is. So another ambiguity that I'm seeing that I'm a little confused by is the timeline of this poem. When are things happening? When did the police come? When is it that he dies? When is it that she's reckoning with this? So I would love your guys' help in trying to figure out what do you see as the timeline or like the chronological order of what's happening in this poem. So take a minute, maybe look it over for a second, gather your thoughts for yourself, and then I'd love to hear your opinions. What happens first?
Okay, so this is the second launch of a science rehearsal where the teacher is setting up a discussion of genetically modified organisms, or GMOs. So again, take a look at this and think about the difference between this and the previous launch.
Discussion would fall into a point in the year in our biotechnology unit, which I didn't really do last year. I didn't do very much depth at all last year, so I kind of want to make it into a mini unit after genetics and heredity. And
did I miss where you are?
Washington, D.C.
Yep, you said that.
Yeah, so I'm going to try to two different parts. I had like a dissolution warm up where it would be a fair share, and then go to the discussion. And then some of it I have a few slides, just kind of very visual. Alright, so everyone has, so this point you want to break on the and then. This is just what you would always have for discussion, so anytime we did a discussion, you would just have this out. Right. And then this is your sheet for today. Which is feeling like a lot of paper, but I see it in front of everyone. All right, so in front of you, you should have three pieces of paper for today. You've come prepared with your discussion preparation. You've read about GMOs. You've filled out your tables with process your thoughts. You're going to have your discussion norms and sentence starters in front of you. Excellent. And then what you should put right in front of you that we're going to work on is your sheet with the graph, which is what we're going to be starting with. So this is going to be our discussion warm-up before we move into our full group discussion. So what we're going to do, you're going to take 30 seconds on your own to jot down from this graph your what I see and what it means from anything on the graph, right? So 30 seconds, you're going to write down what I see and what it means.
So maybe take a minute to turn and talk to the person next to you. What do you notice as being different between example one and example two?
There's so much stuff that it's hard to know, and I didn't know what ideas that the teacher would get practicing how to facilitate the discussion. It wasn't there what the kids were supposed to talk about.
So maybe we should talk to the whole group for just a second. So what do you notice, and you know, does this raise any questions for you about the definition of tightly or loosely constrained?
An observation, excuse me, a clarification about the tightly or loosely. So in the first one, I felt like I was putting my pretend student hat on, like throughout the entire thing. I just jumped right into that. But then in the second one, I had my teacher hat on initially for a big part of it, and then tried to switch over to my like pretend student hat, but it was a little bit messy because we spent so much time on the teacher hat side. So I'm curious if like tightly and loosely constrained means also, or if you saw a difference in like in the tightly constrained, there was less of that teacher hat talk and more just like authentic or like practice. Whereas the loosely constrained, there was more of the more messy space of teacher hat, student hat, teacher hat, student hat. And I hadn't done it as an observer so directly like that, so it was interesting to have that experience. I don't know if anyone else felt that, like, in the second one, I keep switching back and forth, and how does that impact the way I'm experiencing this?
Yeah. I feel like that's a little bit what Sarah was alluding to before. Yeah. Sarah, you want to speak to that?
Yeah, I think we haven't done the analysis yet, although we were talking about this earlier this week, trying to see if there's a relationship between teachers moving in and out of character between talking to students versus talking to teachers, and the levels of constraint on rehearsal. Our guess is from the time we've spent with the data that there is a relationship like that. That wouldn't be surprising because in the very tightly constrained rehearsals, the teachers who are in a group together have a very shared context. They are all working with the same text. They are all working on the same learning goal. They're all working on a set of the same things. And so they don't need to break character as much to explain to one another what's going on or what the expectations are. There are drawbacks to that, right? There are trade-offs of creating that kind of a shared context because you're unable to make it match as tightly to your specific context with your kids in your room. So one is not necessarily better than another. However, I think for the purpose of practicing something like responding to student thinking, there are benefits, potentially, to constraining things like text, learning goal, instructional routine, for the purposes of creating a practice opportunity.
You know what, Sarah, it was really striking to me in thinking about what we did with history, because our goal with the rehearsals was always to provide teachers time to simultaneously practice the skill we're teaching them and develop lessons and collect documents. Mm-hmm. And it didn't even occur to me how muddy that makes the water. Now, the upside is they left with a lot of resources for themselves and from each other, which I think was really special. But as far as being precise and practicing the precise skill, it clearly was lost. And it's so obvious when I think about them in comparison to one another.
Well, that's actually a good question. Is their time more valuable than spent with a group of peers? Is it more valuable to practice and have rehearsals in that group, which you might not have other opportunity for, or to do that resource share? Like, what is the most bang for your buck in that time with this group of peers?
And I want to say,
this was a really interesting question that arose for us a lot, which is, we have no way of assessing which time spent which way is better or worse, but we were able, by spending time in the data, to realize that different cohorts were doing fundamentally different things. Mm-hmm.
Cohorts or content areas?
Content areas. I've been calling them content cohorts.
And I know you haven't done cross-year analysis yet. We may also see differences by cohort, even in the same content area. Because I know we did a lot of adjusting based on the temperament of a cohort.
go ahead. I was just saying, one of the things that Steve and I talked about that struck us in watching the two videos is that Steve said, like, correct me if I'm paraphrasing, but said, like, I knew what I was being asked, like, with the, I'm supposed to try to think about the timeline of the poem. And in the second one, with getting so much of the context, you kind of got bogged down a little bit in the procedural. So when she did launch the pre-discussion question, it was kind of hard to know exactly what was the question that she was asking, because you're like, this is the graphic organizer, and this is the document, and all that. And it did make me get on that student hat of, like, how do I follow all this, and what is the question I'm supposed to be responding to?
Yeah. So there may be something also just about the experience of the rehearsal and what it feels like to be a part of it and to be a participant.
But what the goals were, like, I think from watching those two clips, you can kind of get a sense of what the directions were for the rehearsal.
Mm-hmm. So we kind of be surprised.
I think you're just making a really good point, because I think the part of what we're doing with this study is we're trying to paint a picture of what practicing responsiveness looks like and how you can do that in professional development. And that's not necessarily what all of Hollyhock was about. So I think it's important that we don't, you know, hold these up as, like, here's an example of one set of folks practicing responsiveness and other people trying to do that and failing. That what we really are showing is that we had very different goals, that they were, you know, working on the 5 E's, working on historical thinking, working on the design of documents for different things. There were very clearly different goals with these different sets of rehearsals. And we just want to be clear that one potential goal is practicing responsiveness. And if you want to do that, there are ways to constrain your rehearsal so that teachers focus in very narrowly on that one thing.
Okay, so I'll show you a couple of findings from the other two sections, which were the facilitation section and then the reflection section. So in terms of facilitation, we looked at the videos of the teachers actually rehearsing in the rehearsing. And what we were looking for is, you know, obviously one of the affordances of rehearsal is that, you know, there is the possibility of doing this work of responding to student thinking. So one of the pitfalls that we saw across the content areas was sort of this propensity to break character and talk about what you would do instead of staying in the moment and talking about and actually working through the quote student thinking that was coming up. And so I'm going to show you two clips of this. And I think that, so in the first clip I'll show you, the teacher kind of gets to a certain moment mid-rehearsal where she makes the decision to step out of character and start talking about the next lesson. And then the second clip that I'll show you, the teacher kind of sticks with the rehearsal, even though maybe it's a little bit of a messy moment of student thinking, and you know, works through his responses to that student thinking. And I think what's important about these two examples is the second clip, it doesn't really feel that surprising in some ways because it kind of looks just like a teacher facilitating his class. But what's interesting about it is that I think it's quite rare in PD settings that this is what's happening. The default, I think, is to talk about what I would do, or you know, or to provide, you know, sort of back information or context. So this act of sticking in the enactment and dealing with the student thinking that comes up is actually kind of a unique thing. So as you're looking at this clip, think about when and why this teacher breaks character.
Good. Now, so basically you're good in looking at what you see from the diagram and figuring out what it means. And now we are going to look at the web as itself and create an activity to unlock some vocabulary words. Okay? So this is another activity, you have to have them.
Is that the words that are on here? I know I've seen names besides things, but I didn't know what.
So I'm going to be discussing with you. So that's just like that crossing diagram, because I'm proceeding to another activity that they will be having this afternoon. We're having a web of words. So that will give them that they will be coming and picking up words by group. But we have the grouping is actually like they assign leaders, presenters, note taker, and timekeeper. So the leader will come and pick this up, whatever word is assigned to them, organism, you have to write at the middle, and they can write, as an example, this one. This one. Like this one. So,
And so this is the second example where, and so, you know, as you think about this, maybe think what might cause this teacher to stay in the rehearsal. And it also may help to know that the person who's rehearsing is not in the frame. He is off to the side. This is a participant.
And then Pericles would make you believe that his people had more participation, but if you look at the actual chart in document 8, they don't. There's only 12% is, so I don't know. What are we using as our definition for effective?
Great question. Who would like to help create a definition for effective?
Well, I think of effective government, I think actually representing your populace, the whole populace. And so for me, just to kind of go back to this, Athens doesn't really represent its full populace, so it can't actually be effective at responding to their needs, because they're not all participating in the government.
Okay. Does anyone have any counter thoughts to the definition proposed, or can we all accept that as the definition for the purpose of this discussion?
Can we clarify, Sarah, can you clarify what your definition was, like,
is that it's, what's the word, response?
I need to clarify that all citizens are able to participate in their government. And then the government can be
involved. Excellent, thank you. So do we all accept that as a great definition of a useful one?
I don't think it goes far enough.
Okay.
I think it also has to include the ability to make decisions. And that has to be, you know, as a part of it, it's great to have everyone involved, but if it just becomes a quagmire and nothing gets done, then you're not an effective government, even if everyone forces it.
Okay, so both representation as well as action. With that idea, going to the text, which do you believe?
So, I'll just open it up to the group. What did you notice about when and why the first teacher broke character? And do you have any thoughts on what might have contributed to the second teacher staying in character, even through sort of the student talk that was coming up? Want to turn and talk?
Okay.
What did you notice?
Hi, how are you? I'm Melissa. Hi, nice to meet you.
Hey.
I noticed she broke character when she got a clarifying question. So the student, the teacher who was acting as a student said, you mean these words or these words? And then she started to go back into direction and procedure rather than dealing within the moment of like, well, okay, you asked me to think about this, but I'm all confused because of which words are you talking about? And so that's when she wrote when what she was asking them to think about wasn't clear to them what they were supposed to think about, at least that student.
Everyone I would be in a scenario like a great character, because I would think that they would have asked a question, because I would have made it, I would have said that's clearly earlier, when in actuality it's very like, how would this go? And she interpreted it like, oh, well, that's a question that she interpreted like, she wouldn't have asked, or a real scenario, she's just explaining.
What would have happened? Well, and I think she more like acting like, well, they don't have any background. So if I break character and I give more background, then they'll be able to talk about it. Then they didn't end up getting to talk about it at all. We have to do a lecture on the lesson plan. So thoughts on when and why the first teacher broke character. The more times I watch that clip, the more I'm thinking that maybe she interpreted the question as an out-of-character question, which might have contributed to things. But anyway, thoughts that you discussed?
What struck me about her is that, and we didn't discuss this, but I couldn't tell. Usually there's a voice change. Mm-hmm. When I'm talking to my peers, then I become the teacher, and I put on my teacher self, and there's a voice change. There wasn't one for her. And I don't know if it, I don't know why that is, but that's it struck me in the first one.
I think she goes from you to they, and that was my signal there, but I agree. Other thoughts?
I guess I'm wondering about the artifice of doing it, right? So if you talked about responsive teaching isn't doing a thing, right? But the rehearsing kind of doing a thing, then there's a discomfort that you switch out of that role temporarily. So if everyone around the table knows we're playing, then you can step out and say, since we know this, I'm now going to explain that some extra information.
Yeah.
What's interesting about that,
Kavanagh,
is that in some cases, it makes me think about the fact that in some cases, the rehearsals were set up as the teachers were pretending that they were in their classroom and that the kids in the room were, or that their peers were their students. And in other cases, the teachers were teaching their actual peers, people in the room. So the level of artifice is also different in different contexts because of the way, because of the design of rehearsal itself.
I would be interested in that in terms of the intonation and gestures of teachers, depending on that level of artifice, right? So, who's the kind of touching and hand and gesturing is interesting from the different purposes.
Okay, so let me show you a couple of thoughts on the reflection piece of this. I think we're nearing the hour mark here. So the final chunk of analysis was on the reflection piece of the rehearsals. So this is, our analysis was either of the timeouts during the rehearsals where the rehearsal was paused, or of the debrief of the rehearsal. Unlike other pedagogies that we use to support teachers, rehearsal is, as we've talked about, a place where you have the opportunity to engage with the thinking of, you know, peers who are playing students. And so, you know, it gives you a chance to practice engaging with that thinking. And what we saw in debriefs was people took advantage of that affordance sort of to greater and lesser degrees. And what we found was we identified sort of three ways that people were taking advantage of the fact that there was student thinking on the table in the rehearsals. So before I show you those three ways, I actually want to explain this non-example. This is a piece of quality feedback that a coach gave during the debrief of rehearsal. This is a piece of feedback that would not necessarily require students to have been in the room. So she said, "You were very good at letting two people talk and then coming into the discussion, and I don't know if that was intentional or not, or if it was just the flow, but that's something moving forward to know that you do. Giving two people or three people a chance to talk before you try to do a facilitation move, just as you're trying to facilitate." So I think we can all agree that this is a useful piece of feedback for a teacher. Let two or three people talk before you try to jump in again. I think we can also probably agree that that students did not have to have been in the room, and students as peers, in order for a coach to give this type of feedback. So it's, we just wanted to point this out as a piece of good quality feedback, which is not the same as the type of talking about student thinking that we saw happening in the debriefs. So there were sort of three ways that we saw people reflecting on student thinking. One was they actually drew on their experience as a student in the rehearsal to reflect on how it felt for themselves. They reflected on moments where they thought the rehearsing teacher could have responded to student thinking. And then third, they talked about how they could have, and they pointed out moments where they did respond to student thinking. I think that this is important because we have in some ways a lot of ways to think about preparing teachers for what to do before kids speak. We have ways to help them think about what questions to ask, how to write their lesson plans, even ways to scaffold them up to the point of getting involved in the conversation. I think we have a lot fewer ways to think about how to practice what happens after they talk. So these were a few ways that we found teachers thinking about responding to student thinking. So this first example is from the debrief of a math rehearsal, and it's an example of that that type of reflecting on one's experience as a student. So as you watch this, maybe think about how did the unique role of student thinking during the rehearsal inform this reflection.
I fine-tune certain problems, and as we get further and further in, I think it's hard to keep the questions broad in general. But I did notice towards the end, you said a question two different ways. In the first way, it was like, I know as a teacher, I'd want to give the full in-depth response, but as a student, I would just say yes or no, because it was like, do you think? that this will create some sort of change. And I'm like, but then you said it as what would happen if we change this, and that made me think about it as like a series of consequences for the progress. And like, I couldn't have waited. And I think that has been a big learning.
She finishes the sentence. So that's been a big learning point for her, to the way she words questions. So this second example is a reflection where a teacher is offering a point of praise for where she thinks her colleague did a good job of responding to student thinking. This is from a science person.
I thought that you handled Sadie's like getting it well, and maybe like, because you kind of slowed her down. She clearly understood the concept. You slowed her down and like got all of us on board. So you kind of gave a name to what she said and then allowed the rest of us to discuss it and kind of prove it. So I think that was a good way of dealing with
And then this last one is from a timeout, or where a coach has paused a history rehearsal and sort of surfaces a way that the teacher could do some work to respond to student thinking.
I also noticed that from 1840 to 1890, this is the time period when all these inventions are happening. And so you can infer that the increase in inventions has led to an increase in jobs.
Where else, you guys don't have to raise your hand, but where else do you see economic growth within this document?
Don't point in right here, just we see an opportunity here where Allison and I was going from this, from document A to the timeline, and just to call it up, right? This might be just an opportunity to post something and name what Allison's just done, right? She's just corroborated across these two documents. And we've talked about this week making, upholding models of thinking, right? So she's just done something that I think is a nice thing. What we want students to be doing, corroborate. So there's just a posting opportunity.
So I would say, like, I would summarize what she was saying, or ask somebody else to summarize what she said.
Either one, you could.
Like, you notice Allison's cooperated something. Rarely you like name it.
Yeah, I mean, I might just say, nice. You see that Allison's just corroborated between these two documents. You know, corroboration is something that we do in this class all the time. We want to compare across multiple sources. Nicely done, and then just keep posting it. Right, okay. That's all.
I see that Allison. What Allison just did this class is she was able to make connections between two documents. So it's going to help us better meet the objective and gather the evidence necessary. Very good.
So we're going to take just a minute to talk about this idea of where there was consideration of student thinking and the clips. And Take a minute to turn to that.
I'm trying to remember to finish the math one. I mean, the first teacher, the math teacher who explained, she said, when you ask it this way, I know you're hoping that students would give like an open-ended response, but I feel like I could just say yes or no. But when you ask it this way, it led to all these consequences of thinking that I couldn't answer just yes or no. So there she was like surfacing the way students respond to your questions, like that you think you're asking an open-ended question, but if you phrase it in a way that kids can just say yes or no, you're actually shutting down discussion. So that was one way that student thinking was being elicited, and talking about how the teacher was trying to get kids to respond to the math problem.
As you can maybe tell from these slides, if there's one thing that this project has generated, it's a lot of questions. And so, I want us to discuss any and all questions that this has raised for you, but some of the ones that Mike and Sarah and I have been thinking about a lot are kind of what do you gain and what do you lose by constraining rehearsals in different ways? What designs and teacher educator moves might support teachers to stay in character in order to utilize rehearsal as a space for practicing responsiveness? And you know, how can we help encourage reflection and feedback on how to listen and respond to student ideas if that's what we're aiming to do in rehearsal? And so I want to kind of open it up to your thoughts and reactions and ponderings, and this Mike and Sarah are going to jump in on this as well. So.
Jump in on answering questions or jump in on saying something?
Sorry. Whatever you want. Since I was passing the baton.
It made me wonder, I'm looking at the third bullet point. It made me wonder if actually naming the different ways that you could give quality feedback, like you could put yourself in the student's shoes, you could share something that they did well, you could share a missed opportunity, like naming those types of feedback. But I'm wondering, would you do that before, or do you do it after, before the reflection starts? Like, does that matter? Did people do that? Did they name the different ways, or did those just organically occur? But all three of those are helpful, substantive ways to give feedback, to get people to be more responsive in their teaching.
One thing I will say is that those examples in the debrief that we just showed are pretty atypical. So a lot of times in the debrief, actually talking about the ideas that got surfaced is not what happened. So a big question for us is, okay, they were relatively atypical. It isn't what we were seeing across the board in debriefs. There was not that we could find one specific thing that happened in the debriefs that would lead to it. But I do think now that we've identified, it's possible for people to actually really deeply think about what kids said and how to respond to it. We could probably experiment with a few ways of setting up debriefs that would allow for us to test what kinds of setups, what kinds of protocols actually get teachers to really dig into kids' thinking in their debriefs.
I'm not sure that I would want it to come at the expense of a piece of feedback that, like the one that I showed before those three, that it's just, you know, a quality piece of feedback for the teacher. But I agree with Sarah that there might be some ways of setting up the feedback so that people would be, perhaps have a heightened awareness of these ways of responding.
I think there's something to what you're saying, as well as the timeline and how often they're getting to rehearse. And I'm saying that now that I'm on a second project that uses rehearsals, where we meet 6 times during the school year, and as a team they rehearse. So it's got a fair number of differences from how that, but the rehearsal and the PQP protocol is similar. And there's a tendency of the teachers to want to give the feedback to each other that's about what a good job you did, and not dig into the purpose that we set for the thing that they're rehearsing. And we have continued to both model how to give the PQP feedback, and the sentence stems, particularly starting at the praise, because they're way more comfortable with the praise. And by rehearsal 5 out of 6, I'm starting to see a little shift. But I just think it's a very hard thing to learn, and I don't know how much we've embedded it in the learning to be a teacher and developing your teaching over time.
This brings up yet another question for me, which is what rehearsals, how they might look different from the first summer to the second summer. Sorry, Nicole.
Similarly to what I was thinking was that one of the questions I had about the differences between those two teachers, rehearsals where one stepped out of character and one didn't, I had a question about a willingness to be vulnerable in that community. Because the second one, these are Angela's second summer folks, and we have this really beautiful willingness to be vulnerable that's pervasive in the cohort. And it made me think about if that really weighs in on how all in am I going to go. And knowing about that particular group for you all, that's not the pervasive feeling. So it really
and makes it was our hard cohort.
Mm-hmm. It makes me wonder how important the role of community is to the effectiveness of the reverse.
Just a point of clarification, though, that history video was from 2015 Summer Institute, right?
Oh, maybe that was the first.
So that was their first year too.
Oh, I was thinking that was the second.
I think of this idea of reflection, right? What we're asking people to do and what we're asking people to think about. And I think in some of, and what I'm remembering about like the task cards and how we set up debriefs in general, I think it's in the way we ask the question. You're going to get the answer to what you ask. So if you're saying, give praise, you're going to give praise about anything. If you say, give a praise about what students were thinking about, right? It's in the prompt. You're going to get a different kind of reflection. So there's something there in the way questions, how we framed the debrief or how we framed the task, right? Which is what Sarah's getting at. But there's something in what if we ask, they're going to answer it.
I think that's the track I was trying to explain the work we're doing in PSC, because we have changed the prompts and we have tried to model it. It's shifting. But it's not as dramatic as I'd like it to be.
And maybe it's the explicitness of it. Like, you know, maybe we're trying to get to it. We want them to do this, but we're kind of going around and maybe we're
but
just
I
not
think,
asking for
I
it.
I think there's factors like Nicole's talking about.
Yeah.
I mean, I think depending on the comfortability and the culture that cohort has been set up around sort of determines whoever's giving that feedback the level at which you give feedback to. Because sometimes I think it's like if you're feeling that people don't think it's a safe place to really give the kind of feedback that you want to give, then you're going to kind of soften that feedback, but it comes at a price. And so it's not until, and I can speak for myself because I was really trying to learn how to do all this. But it's really interesting because I told Tammy and Janet and Tammy told me that the second year was going to be a little bit different. But this is the year that I've been able to really like do what I really wished I could have done the first time around, because I have a lot more experience. But there's also a more of a level of trust. And so it's just, I don't know if that plays into it or not, but I think there's something to be said about what Nicole had brought up around that piece as well.
I think another important thing I think about is, so Mary and Sarah and I wrestled a little bit with what are our findings, and in some ways we said our biggest finding was that if you want to get good at responsive teaching, then what you have to do is put student thinking at the center of everything you're doing, and that's our big finding. And that's not something that throughout Hollyhock we talked about. But it is something I think that if we, in terms of what we were trying to show through this study, and what we found by just looking at this particular set of data that happens to be the Hollyhock data, that in those places where student thinking was held in the center, then we saw teachers really being responsive to student thinking, which is, you know, somewhat of a self-fulfilling prophecy. But in terms of like something like feedback, if we're asking teachers the question, how was student thinking centered in this particular rehearsal? How did you respond to student thinking? What were the moves around student thinking that were particularly effective? Then you get people to really think about that responsiveness to student thinking. And otherwise, we were asking them about things like the amount of feedback or the number of turns of talk between people, which are important technical pieces of the work, but aren't necessarily responsive to student thinking. And so that whole sort of technical side of it, we need to be giving teachers technical feedback on some of the moves that they're making, but that's a different thing than thinking about in what ways they're really listening to student ideas, processing those ideas, and then giving ideas back to students that help build their sense making. And so that's a little bit what we're trying to show. But again, I think that's a something that at least I wasn't thinking about when I was designing, you know, the rehearsals for Hollyhock. That wasn't forefront in my mind. If I did it again now, I think I would design things differently to really think about, okay, how do we elicit student thinking in really powerful ways, and how do we help teachers build around that student thinking in particularly responsive ways?
I'll build on that to say that I think the default typically in designing ways to give feedback is to focus feedback on teacher behaviors. So even just praise as a prompt is read as, I'm going to give you praise, teacher, on your behaviors that you have and flipping the, potentially, we have to test this out because we didn't have examples of this actually from the Hollyhock data, but flipping that script to say, okay, in our defense, what we're going to do is we're going to take, everybody take a minute, and I want you to write down what are all of the different ideas that surfaced. And from that, we're going to start talking about how and in what ways during this rehearsal those ideas actually got wrestled with, and whether we had it to do again, we would wrestle with them differently. That would prompt a really different kind of discussion among the teachers debriefing the rehearsal. And I think there's an open question for us, which is, if helping teachers practice responding to students' thinking is really what we want to promote, what various designs can we try out for rehearsal, both for how the rehearsal itself is designed and for how the debrief is designed, that would support that as being the center of what people are working on, as opposed to their predetermined behaviors that they would enact regardless of what is said.
I'm also thinking about how, at least I set up rehearsals and how we talk about like teachers playing students, and whether that factors into like being less focused on student thinking because we're like faking it essentially, right? And admitting that we're faking it. So if there's even more focus put on like, this isn't just about how the teacher's responding, but about this the student thinking as best as we can recreate it, like that's a really important piece of the setup that I think we
have. That reminds me of the example we saw where the one teacher broke character and the other teacher stayed in. The question that was on the table in that history discussion was, how do we define effective government? I mean, we could sit here as ourselves and debate that for the next, you know, 3 hours and have a really lively conversation. We would be authentic learners and sense makers in that moment. And so that sort of, if you can think of ways to take away the play acting part of it and put out those questions that adults can wrestle with, that we also want our students to wrestle with, if those are the kinds of things that we use for these rehearsals, I think we get that authentic thinking on the table, and then a teacher has a much better chance to practice playing with authentic thinking in that moment.
I want to be mindful of the time, because I'm not exactly sure what time we're supposed to end, but I know that...
5:30.
Okay. Because I know people have stayed late to do this. So then the next part is thank you. So thanks very much for walking through this, these findings of this, and asking all of your questions, which contribute very meaningfully to our large pile of questions. And I hope that it was useful to you and interesting. Thanks.
All right, Mike and Sarah, we're going to retire to the reception area for the reception. Yes. Feel free to join us.
No fair.
Good to see everybody.
Bye.
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 Bye. Bye.
Your shirt is falling off, so I should hang up. Do you want me to hold your arm now?
Sure, I'm
taking
myself out.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
Now
it
could be
longer.
Make sure you help better. Yourself to some of the food out here.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Like content, like the three of them, with like our content.
Yeah. Hey, Mary, I have a question. So,
watching the piece at the beginning.
You cut your hair?
I feel like there was
looks cute.
A fly.
You didn't, don't seem too interested.
It needs to grow.
I like it.
It doesn't even really go to ponytail, which is a problem.
And then we also were trying to get data some other way, and that fell through, so I waited like 4 months, and I could be working with someone I knew, which is a little bit like, but someone who like knew someone higher than me promised me they would have texted me, they never did, so I was like, oh, well, 4 months ago, I couldn't do what I'm doing right now, thank you. So, anyway, that's where I am, so a little stressed out about that, but, I mean, it like, I don't know. I do have a backup, but a backup would put me at for sure 6 years.
No, but if you
like,
want to practice
the project starting right now with
Omega.
So it's like, do I want, like, so I have a backup, but I'm like, need to think of like a 5 year backup, you know?
Backup A,
exactly. So it's like, I have a backup that I like, but then there's like the backup that I could like scrap together if I need.